"Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" He said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and the first commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. The whole law and the prophets depend on these two commandments."
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Dear brothers and sisters, this is one of those great, great Gospels. It is also called the Commandment of Love. It is one of those syntheses so short, so compact, so powerful that really can change completely our life. See, we've got a little issue here. Yep, getting all it. Good. So I'd like to address this homily in two parts. The first one, I'll target more your head, and hopefully in the second one, a bit more your heart. When you hear the word commandment or law, what comes to your heart? What do you think? Normally, especially today with our millennial population and myself as well, we're like, oh, there comes another thing we have to do. Have you ever had like, oh, this is my huge to-do list and this is all that I have to do? And sometimes the law and the commandments seem so heavy. I've got to go to Mass every Sunday, and I can't lie, and I can't steal, and I have to be good to my enemy, and I have to also pray for them, and I have to, and I have to, and I have to, and I have to. And you're like, oh my God. Sometimes that's our relationship with the law. But maybe some of you might have the exact opposite experience. Maybe some of you are experiencing, well, thank God there's a law. If you were a prisoner of war and the enemy follows the convention of Geneva, you're very thankful for that law because they won't kill you or torture you. If you're driving down a street and there's a stop sign and actually someone stops and you drive through and you don't crash, you will say, oh, thank God there's a law. If you're from Latin America like myself, you say, oh, thank God there's a law, there's order. You can walk down the street in the night and nobody will steal from you. And you say, well, praise God there's a law. And praise God we have laws. So sometimes we have these mixed feelings about laws. Sometimes they seem like a burden and all of that, and sometimes they seem like great. And unfortunately, many times the optic on that is my own benefit. If it's going to help me, the law is great. If it's going to make me have to pay taxes or whatever, then the law is horrible. And that is not the optic that Jesus is giving us. Let's try to change our mind and look at things as Jesus is teaching us. From the Old Testament, way, way, way back there, the law was a gift. Can I say that again? The law is a gift. It's the gift of God to His people. It's the gift to show us in His wisdom, in His almighty wisdom, what is the path to life. I love this chapter 4 from Deuteronomy that I'm going to read to you guys, because I think in a way it expresses this sense of how great the law is that we have received from God. "Now, Israel, hear the decrees and laws I am about to teach you. Follow them so that you may live." From the very beginning, there was this connection. If I follow the law, I will live. And in verse 7, it says, "What other nation is there so great as to have their gods near to them, the way the Lord our God is near to us whenever we pray to Him?" What nation is there that has such a wonderful God that is so close to us? They ask themselves. We can ask ourselves, what people is there that has their God so close. And then he continues in the next verse. And what other nation is there so great as to have such righteous decrees and laws as this body of laws I am setting before you today? There is deep wisdom in the law of God. That wisdom is the wisdom of life. As it says also in the Old Testament, I put before you life and death. You have to choose. Are you going to follow me? Are you going to obey my laws? Are you going to choose life? That's what God is putting before you. Now, I think it is a very important, still in the realm of the mind, how do I obey these laws? Because there's two ways. Well, there are many, but we could categorize them in two big ways of obeying and following the law. And in both cases, they're actually doing what the law says, but they're very different in the way they do it. And you have to ask yourself, how do I follow the commandments of God? How do I say, I'm not going to steal, I'm not going to lie, I'm not going to judge these people, I'm going to treat them charitably, I'm going to be empathic, I'm going to be generous. How do you do that? There's two ways. You can do that as a slave, or you can do that as a child. The slave obeys the laws of his master or her master. But what is in the heart of that slave usually, or in this caricature of the slave? It is the fear of punishment. And boy, is there punishment if we do not follow the law of God. So many times and so many people. When you see people choosing the path of not of the Lord, you see how they suffer. You see the addictions, the troubles, a lot of it. And the slave is looking at the punishment. And the slave is not free. The slave feels compelled and obliged to follow these laws. I have to go to Mass. If not, it's terrible. Oh, I better go there. My parents are going to be so angry with me. I'm going to suffer so much. It's easier just to go to Mass. 1 hour, that's all. I can even daydream through it. It doesn't matter. I'm just there. Just have to go to communion so that they see everything is okay, and that's it. Bingo. Got my prize. Don't get punished. That's the slave, not free. That's not what God wants. The child on the other side is the one who obeys the law out of love. The child is aware that there is a punishment, that if he doesn't choose this, there will be consequences. But above all, he does this, she does this, because the child is in love with the parents, with the father, and does this freely out of an option. I want to go to Mass because I love it. Because I love your love, because I love your nourishment, because I love your word, because I love the wisdom, I love the people, I love the architecture, I love whatever list of things you love. Why are you here today? Do you come as a slave or as a child? Why do you follow the commandments of God? Out of fear or out of love? So that's the mind. Hopefully you got it. It's better to follow the law as a child, obviously. Bingo. Punchline. The heart. Let me tell you a little story about myself that has been very close in my heart. So at the beginning of this month, and this doesn't happen regularly, thank God, my uncle in Mexico got kidnapped. Yeah. Big deal. We had a friend of ours who got kidnapped in Colombia. He actually got kidnapped by the doorman, and the doorman just sold him to a gang who actually afterwards sold him to the FARC, thinking he was a great millionaire and whatever, and actually he didn't have that much money. So he spent 11 months almost dying several times in the jungle in Colombia. So when we heard that my uncle was kidnapped, obviously my whole family freaked out, which is kind of like normal. Because you have no idea. You have no idea. He just, poof, vanished. And here comes the beautiful thing. The day we knew, which was the morning of October 12th, my sister, who's a consecrated laywoman, a sister, she's a very holy person. She got down on her knees and she said, you know the new saint, Beato Carlo Acutis, you know, the new millennial saint, the one and only. Well, she said, this guy is brand new, I'm going to pray to him. And she, and my uncle is her godparent. And lo and behold, that same day, October 12th, the day of our Blessed Mother and the day of Carlo Acutis, his celebration day, they found him by miracle. The police tripped into the van where they were transporting him from one place to another. My sister was, my whole family, we were like, oh, man, this is incredible. He was in captivity only 6 days, which is really record time. Why do I tell you all this story? Because when I hear that, when I experience this, my heart is like, God, I love you. Of course, the scientist in me could say it's a coincidence and all that stuff, but I shut up my head and say, God, I love you. And at that moment, that scientist was definitely not speaking. What am I saying with all of this? What is stopping you from loving God crazily? God is the absolutely best thing on planet Earth. It's the best lover there is. It's the one and only. He's just amazing. He's so generous, so giving. What is stopping you from tapping into all that love? What is stopping you from loving him back? You know, you've already heard many times of FOMO, fear of missing out. Well, guys, we're missing out badly. We're missing out badly. The love of God is the most sweet thing. And what happens with the heart when we experience his love, when we experience his miracles, his kindness, his presence, his unconditional love, especially in the sacrament of confession, when you go there unworthy and just receive grace and beauty, what happens to a heart that is loved? Very naturally, you can see it in children who are in healthy families. Very naturally, they love back. And it's not perfect because we have sin, but that's the bottom line. Dear brothers and sisters, my encouragement for you is fall in love with God. Open your hearts to his love. How can that happen if you barely come to Mass? Encourage your friends and family to go. I know there's a lot of people who are afraid of going to Mass still. Even students, very young students around here, I meet them on Locust Walk or down at Drexel, and I say, oh, hello, how are you? So you just arrived? No, I've been here the whole pandemic. Oh, I haven't seen you at Mass. Oh, no, it's not safe. And I say, well, you know when we started? We started in June. And in all these months, how many cases have we had in our congregation? Zero. I think that's reasonably safe. That's a pretty good statistic. Guys, you're the good guys who are already coming. Encourage those who are around you to come as well, that they might experience the love of God, that they might experience this crazy loving God that forgives absolutely everything and just pours love and love and love and just wants his children to love him, to be free, to follow the path of life. So again, dear brothers and sisters, God puts before you life and death. You are the one who needs to choose.